And without further ado, we'll do one more item to kickstart this session and share with you two award winners, the second place and first place award winners from our international video contest. The second place winner, the title of the film is Drops of Life. It was submitted by Seema Mughal of Greenwich University in Pakistan. And immediately following the second place prize winner, we'll play the first place prize winner video, which is called Learning is Beneficial. It's by Sheila Kwaru Agbapki. And it's from, she is a student at Ashesi University in Ghana.
The Adesuyan Illiteracy Foundation was officially launched in October 2012 in Berkusu, located in the Eastern region. Adesuyan is a phrase in the Akan language, which literally means learning is beneficial. As such, the aim of Adesuyan is to improve literacy rates in the country by teaching adults how to read, write, and perform basic arithmetic. As it stands, about 50 residents have been enrolled in the program. The Ashesi community plays a major role in the running of the Adesuyan program, from the use of lecture halls to trained student volunteers who teach the Berkusu residents. It is not just about the theory. Adesuyan students are taught how to apply what they have learned in real-life situations. This includes filling bank drafts, writing checks, and performing basic math.
Well, in terms of calculations and measurement, it has helped me a lot. Because this work is all about calculation and reading of plans. If you don't know how to calculate or read in plan, you can't build. Either you'll be a laborer till you die. But I don't want that thing to happen to me. That's why I decided to improve my skills.
In a bid to expose the students to their Ghanaian identity, history, and places of interest, the Adesuyan students visited the National Museum and airport. Here, students were able to identify with key words and phrases they had been taught, which are associated with these places.
It brings me a lot of happiness to see that they are learning every single day.
I was absolutely blown away. How passionate they were about what they were doing.
Take every single day and make that an opportunity to implement real change.
Adesuyan has come to help Ghana in a very, very big way.
Moveni. I have to say Guemora. Good morning. That's better. Bonjour. Wie geht's? What about Zrasvitya? Zrasvitya. Jambo sana. Vanenshi Rafiki Yangu. Assalamu alaikum wa alaikum. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I want to greet all of you on a very special occasion for the Talwar Network, because we have the presence today of a very distinguished South African, Naledi Pandor, on this occasion. I just want to quickly introduce myself, and then I'll introduce her. My name is Shams Kasim Laka, and I'm founding president of the Aga Khan University. I'm a member of the Board of Governors in Higher Education Commission of Pakistan, and am currently the executive chair of the University Central Asia's board. I'm a former minister of Pakistan in education, as well as the Ministry of Science and Technology, something we both have a little bit in common. And really, I have the greatest honor to serve on the Talwar Network since its founding. And as a member of the steering committee, I'm just absolutely delighted that the incoming members are so committed. I see them around, and the president of the steering committee, Tony Monaco, who is president of Tufts University. So it's nice to see several of us stepping down, and the health of the organization is as vibrant as we have seen. In fact, I've never seen it so vibrant. So congratulations to all of you. Before I introduce the minister, I just want to introduce to the minister our student contingency. Could the students please take a bow? Just rise up. Thank you. Several of the students have already left, but there were 40 of them who were invited specially to participate, and they have really I would say they have provided a leavening effect to our conference. That's all I can say. We are fortunate to have with us this morning Naledi Pandor, who is acting president of the Republic of South Africa, and also the Minister of Science and Technology, a position she previously held between 2009 and 2012. Minister Pandor received her BA from the University of Botswana and Swaziland, and an MA in education from the University of London. In 1997, now hear this, while serving as an MP, she received a second MA in linguistics from the University of Stellenbosch, South Africa, right here. And while she was a serving MP, it tells you that continuing education is in her blood. I would like to then go on to let you know that she was the first female chancellor of the Cape Technikon, which later merged with the Peninsula Technikon in 2005 to form the Cape Peninsula University of Technology in Cape Town. Minister Pandor has played a leading role in South African politics and education policy planning and reform. She was elected to Parliament in 1994 and served as Deputy Chief Whip of the African National Congress, ANC, in the National Assembly from 95 to 98. She became Deputy Chairperson of the National Council of Provinces in 1998 and served as Chairperson from 1994 to 2004. What a distinguished political career. Pandor became Minister of Education in 2004, then Minister of Science and Technology in 2009, a position she held until she was appointed Minister of Home Affairs. Earlier this year, she was reappointed as Minister of Science and Technology, and it is a true honor to have her with us today, and please join me in welcoming Her Excellency Minister Naledi Pandor, please.
Thank you very much for that very kind introduction. I'm not always sure that it's deserved at all. Good morning, everyone. And let me also show some linguistic prowess. Dumelang. Good morning. Bonjour. Assalamu alaikum. I'm happy to be given the honor to speak to you this morning, although with some trepidation, because you've had several days of conferencing, and I have no idea what you've discussed in the days prior to my presence here this morning. So if I go over old ground, do forgive me, or if I'm irrelevant, it's my fault entirely, and if I'm on the mark, I'll be really happy. So I'm sorry I could not follow all the proceedings of your conference, but I'm really pleased that you are meeting in South Africa and that the network is continuing to grow from strength to strength. I'm really pleased that the network has developed a strong collaborative partnership that is committed to community engagement in higher education. All of us know that community engagement continues to be a subject that enjoys much debate among policymakers and academic institutions. I'm not aware at present of any South African university that does not have some form of community engagement program. So it has begun to take root in our institutions. And I must say there was a great deal of debate about its relevance and presence in higher education. I recall many colleagues, when I taught in higher education, were wondering what was being asked of them, and actually felt that all they should be doing is teaching and research. Why should they go out into the community? But today, you'll find it very hard to identify one academic who would say such a thing. It's like finding somebody who supported apartheid in South Africa. You can't find them anymore. So it's really taken quite a strong root in our society. I think given the role that universities play in generating new knowledge, new products, and new ideas, it makes absolutely common sense to seek out civic engagement and social responsibility. In our country, community engagement is made even more important by the distance that continues to exist between communities and institutions. Although we have made advances in bringing our institutions closer to the community, there still exists a distance. And thus, a form of engagement that bridges the gap and that draws communities closer to our institutions of higher learning is, I think, very, very important. Since the advent of democracy, we've had many non-traditional students coming into our universities as first-generation entrants. A well-designed set of community engagement programs can, I believe, ensure that young people do not become disengaged community members divorced from society and their community. So really entrenching community engagement is for me a way of building a very strong and dynamic link between graduates and our communities throughout our society. So it allows us to ensure that we are not producing graduates who become apathetic about our society. Often, those who develop community engagement initiatives see their plans as part of the three commitments higher education should act on, those of research, teaching, and community engagement. I think this is somewhat of an inadequate understanding of the value and purpose of community education, engagement. The programs are, in my mind, not service providers or NGO-type programs. They're designed to develop, or should be, to develop a new ethos among graduates, an appreciation of the inextricable link between human development and intellectual rigor. If we don't see the training that we receive as part of training us for development, then I think we're going awry in higher education. I say this thinking very much about the role that I believe the University of Fort Hare has played in South Africa. I often ask myself, how is it possible for a university such as Fort Hare in the deep rural parts of the Eastern Cape of South Africa, how is it possible for it to have produced a Mandela, an O.R. Tambo, and many, many national and international leaders of our country and other African states? How can it be that a small, little known institution could give rise to such men and women? It says something about ethos, about tangible understanding of the need to commit to society and to altering it. And I've always promised myself that one day I will seek to write the deeper history of Fort Hare and really explore what was in its content that gave rise to such people who could sacrifice without seeking benefit, who could extol the highest virtues without in any way being arrogant or full of pride. So I've always found the university an interesting institution, and sometimes I believe I have a warped belief in the power of higher education because of my appreciation for Fort Hare. But I do believe that higher education can play a very dynamic and important role in transforming our society and those who act within it. I think given the much more serious concept of community engagement that you have developed through the network, your meeting and dialogue on the subject is a very welcome development. The fact that you meet for several days with senior level participants present, vice chancellors, for example, indicates that this is now a very serious activity within the academic community. I think the creation of a network focused on social responsibility coming from higher education is really a signal example of your commitment to sustaining the role higher education can play in developing societies throughout the world. I'm sure you've not reached everyone in our universities as yet, and perhaps we as policymakers need to work with you much more closely to see how we can support your efforts. I recall the meeting of this emerging network, which I attended several years ago in Cairo, in Egypt. I am sure that the network will probably be of immense value to Egyptian higher education institutions as they reshape themselves following the recent political changes. So we should never lose the connection, whatever the circumstances develop in a national context. South Africa also needs your expertise. Our institutions face the challenge of entrenching a new rights-based culture in our country, a critical yet knowledge-based attitude toward policy, toward development, and a commitment to service in some way as part of building a more inclusive and fair society which can successfully overcome the legacies of our deep divisions. So higher education plays an extremely important role. If out of our universities, which are establishments that should produce learned people, if out of them we produce homophobic graduates, if we produce sexist graduates, if we produce racists, if we produce cultural bigots, then we are failing in the role that we should play. So I think always, as higher education institutions think about what they offer young people in terms of curricula, in terms of research opportunity, they also have to think about values, ethics, and character. And I think we don't think enough about that. We sometimes may produce very vocal young people, very angry young people, but not measured in their thinking, not alert to the need for engagement and persuasion. Because while we may emerge believing we're very correct in terms of our intellectual understanding of an issue, but to get it adopted, you need to also alter the way a person views an issue. And that needs a particular way of negotiating with society, which we sometimes don't attend to, because at times we develop the pride of intellectual achievement and inadequate attention to the value of social engagement. So I really think that this network must never define itself in narrow terms of community engagement projects. It must add the element of values and ethics and encourage universities to give much more attention to this sometimes missing element in the work that we do. I'm of course not absolutely certain as to how one weaves some of these imperatives into academic and community engagement work, but I do believe if they are missing, we would have missed our target of changing society, because I assume that we have sought to pursue engagement because we want to change society. It's not an exercise, it's not additional work, it's not because we were bored. It's an intention to make a difference. That's my assumption, taken your presence here. One way in which I think we could pursue the goal of an inclusive society is by strengthening the voluntary social groups that make up civil society. I then am proposing that what we should do is really look at whether we can work more closely with civil society groups such as churches, such as self-help groups that are organized on the internet. Can we influence how they conduct their programs? Can we draw them in a range of ways into a network such as this one? Can we work more closely with trade unions? Can we help develop them, provide support for development training? Can we work with professional associations? Might we even reach political parties, which need a great deal of help? Some of them. So I think these are aspects that we might want to consider as a further expansion of the relationships that we build, because these social groups all play a very crucial role in society and could help us to more effectively balance the power of the state through having these forms of developmental relationships. I think that universities can do more in the field of education itself. I recall some years ago, I had the distinct pleasure of attending the inauguration of the then new Vice Chancellor of the University of Cape Town, Dr. Max Price. And when I wrote this, I didn't know you'd be here, Max. And I remember that when he delivered his inaugural address, he made a number of pledges at the time. And one of his pledges was that the University of Cape Town intended to give special attention to schooling under his leadership. I believed he was absolutely right with that commitment. It was time for a sea change in the scale of support that universities should direct toward the school sector. He was very committed to that undertaking, and I know that the University of Cape Town has built very strong links with the school sector in the Western Cape and in provinces beyond this one. I hope that in his address that he gave here at the conference, he was able to tell you what progress the university has made with some of these important commitments. I would like, having had an association with parts of the network for some years, I'd like to go back a bit in history. In the late 1990s, most South African universities had a wide range of community service projects. It was quite a disparate collection of initiatives. And then just as we were wondering where these projects would go, how they would survive, given our awareness that democracy was on its way and that a sea change would occur in South Africa, we explored with a number of education organizations, what do we do to allow these projects to continue to survive? And we were fortunate. Along came a very interesting organization, the Joint Education Trust. The trust decided to create the Community Higher Education Service Partnership, or CHESP as it was called, in response to government's then first white paper on higher education, which highlighted the need to pursue community engagement. CHESP worked closely with the Department of Education and the Higher Education Quality Committee of the Council for Higher Education to advance community engagement in South African higher education institutions. It was seminal in making community engagement an integral part of teaching and research, a mechanism that was intended to enrich teaching and research with a deeper sense of commitment and application locally of new knowledge. At the time, if I'm not wrong, CHESP was supported by the Ford Foundation, and I think Susan Stroud was responsible for that support, if I'm not wrong, Nassim. I'm going way back in history, but we really benefited from the support that Ford gave to the JET initiatives at the time. CHESP was innovative in identifying various service learning as the entry point into community engagement. It helped our institutions produce better engineers, as well as better architects and better mathematicians, responsive to the needs of communities, including those in the rural hinterland. So we framed a program that would assist those who wish to be involved in community engagement in order that what they were acquiring in higher education would support their community engagement initiatives. Well, today, after those early initiatives, community engagement is no longer on the margins of academic life in our universities. I'm told it's now located in the offices of deputy vice chancellors in some of our universities. And I remember in the past, my own deputy vice chancellor thought we were crazy when we asked him to support community engagement. So we've come a really long way. We are also very excited that we have the introduction in some of our institutions of short courses in service learning for new academics and student leaders. And we also have community engagement included in some of the postgraduate modules in higher education orientation programs. The value of community engagement can be seen in really exciting developments in some of our universities. For example, in the health sciences faculty at the University of Cape Town, out of work led to a great degree by young medical doctors and young health sciences students The university has included the learning of isiXhosa in the curriculum of medical trainees. This wasn't a feature before, but it very quickly became clear that if you were going to treat a patient from a community that only spoke isiXhosa, and you addressed them in a language that would seem to be extremely foreign to them, you were not going to help that patient to get better. Thus, it was important that as a young person intending to work in the medical professional field, you should at least be able to use one language that would help you to reach the community you would serve. And it is through getting to be closer to the community that one realizes the importance of language. And so our university curricula have actually been reshaped through community engagement. In our own department, the Department of Science and Technology, we have a number of programs and initiatives that seek to embed university community engagement in regard to research. We have a lot of action research taking place at our centers of excellence. Most of the policy contributions made by the centers emanate from dialogues and participation by different communities in our center's research activities. We have a very important policy initiative, the South African Research Chairs, which has a number of research chairs focused on community engagement. For example, we have the Research Chair in Development Education, led by Professor Odera Hoppers, who I understand attended and spoke at the conference. She's based at the University of South Africa, and she introduced a new pedagogy in academic research and citizenship education, which takes human development as its goal and explores this through research, postgraduate teaching, and community engagement. She's doing absolutely fantastic work in reshaping young people and young graduates in our country, and is addressing some of the most complex and challenging problems that we're confronted with. We also have awarded two research chairs in science engagement. Science engagement is one of the areas of focus of our new Center of Excellence in Scientometrics and Science Technology and Innovation Policy at the University of Stellenbosch. In addition, we've initiated a three-year community university partnership program under our Human and Social Dynamics in Development at four rural-based universities in South Africa: the University of Fort Hare, University of Limpopo, University of Venda, and University of Zululand. The initiative focuses primarily on the university's responsiveness to social needs and promotion of the interests of the public good. I mention these rural-based universities because I hope you will consider them as partners in the future, because I'm keen to see the network establishing concrete international partnerships between practitioners in community engagement. And we would really love that your links are not just with our urban-based universities, but also reach out to those that are in the most distant hinterland of South Africa. So allow me then, not having understood what you discussed, to close and to really hope that when you visit some of the sites that are sites that I'm told you will be visiting later today, that you will get a sense of some of the initiatives that are led by our universities, and that this will form the basis of future partnerships between your institutions and institutions in South Africa. I've been really delighted to have the opportunity to speak to you this morning, and I'm sure you've had an extremely successful conference. I'm also sure you're extremely tired, and that I have spoken long enough. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Minister, you did not disappoint us. In fact, you challenged us to look at community or civic engagement in ways that we perhaps didn't focus as much on. And that was the issue of value and ethics. And I think that's very critical. And thank you so much for giving us this enlightenment of many, many years of experience. You also encouraged us to forge linkages and relationships with parts of civil society. And civic engagement is very much that. Thank you very much. We've got a few minutes to take questions, and the minister's kindly agreed to respond. So may I invite questions from the audience?
Okay, Derek Barker, Kettering Foundation. I'm not familiar with the term human development, but as I understood it, you were using that as the kind of ultimate purpose of higher education. I'm just wondering if you could explain that. Thank you.
Good. Maybe.
Hello, my name is Laura Jane Watkins. I'm from the University of the Free State. I'm one of the student representatives. I would just like to ask, as a South African student, what would perhaps be the best platform for student engagement or civic engagement in the South African context? And do you think that there's still room for political engagement with a combination of the, civic or community engagement? Thank you.
And so how, in a society like South Africa, where bigotry has been part of our lives for centuries, how do we change, how do we teach old dogs new tricks, both at the level of our graduates as well as the level of the bureaucrats and the academics in the institution?
Your Excellency, thank you very much for that enlightening talk. I'm James Gashumba from University of Rwanda, and most people would know about the history of Rwanda. And even after 20 years, we are still grappling with our history. And I'm not saying that the university has taken a lead role when talk about community engagement in looking at our history and saying, what do we do in shaping or helping the young people to address. I've been actually speaking with some of the young people from South African universities during the course of our engagements and asking, how much are you, the young leaders, taking a lead in making sure that you reshape or you counteract the prejudices of us, my generation? Because in Rwanda, we are focusing on the young people, fully well knowing that changing, you know, teaching old dogs new tricks is harder than getting a puppy, you know, which hasn't started learning bad habits and reshaping it. And we have a program called Ndu Munyarwanda. How do we get the Rwandans to not even remember thinking of Tutsi, Hutu, Twa, but saying I'm Rwandan? Now, I don't know, because I've heard of the Truth Reconciliation Program that was there in South Africa. Is that continuing, or are you saying it has achieved its purpose and let's go on with our job? And how are universities, the institutions that shape the lives of young people, how are universities taking a lead in this? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister.
Well, firstly, on human development, the concept, I think, comes out of a study that was initiated as we approached the new millennium the UN decided to create a task team, a group of well-known personalities who were asked to look at the issue of human security. And out of their work, they generated, they had with them the person who initially developed this concept of human development, which is really to look at the total socio-economic and other needs of an individual, of a community, of a society. So when we use it, I suppose, in the academic setting, we're saying it's not enough to read several Shakespearean plays. Get other genre as well, and then you'll have a full sense of the richness of literature available in the world. That if you deal with only one aspect, how well one writes academically, and not whether you're a critical thinker, whether you can analyze, whether you can draw together an argument from a range of strands, you are not addressing the full set of issues. So for a human being, human development would be, from our perspective, if you're an academic, an awareness of cultural links, religion, language, all those attributes that make up who we are. And we'd, in some way, have to have them at the forefront of our thinking without them becoming dominant. But a lack of awareness of them means the person you interact with actually gets a very narrow sense of what the university or academic experience should be. And it's the same with society, that if you say, I will focus on providing food security, and you don't make literacy available or economic opportunity, you're not addressing the full ambit of human development. That's how I understand it. I might be, inadequately. Professor Hoppers is one of the best people to ask this, but that's how we've understood it. Then with respect to Nora, I think you've really asked an important question. And I would say that one of the platforms is surely student organization. I think, we have many student organizations in our country. You have them on your campus, but they're active in very peculiar things. I was shocked when Minister Nzimande told me that members of the SRC participate in procurement committees on campuses. What are they doing there? You know, they should be doing other things that really support students in a very different way. So I think it would be great if student organizations were to come together and discuss more fully what their understanding of community development or community engagement is, and how they as organizations make a contribution to this area. I think we were fortunate that in the 70s and 80s we had young people who were very strongly committed to being part of the struggle for freedom. But since then we've become a bit lazy. We've become a bit elitist, we're comfortable. And I think we need to generate a new activism. And it's through student organizations coming together. There are national bodies that draw young people together, but I'm not sure what they discuss. I also think in terms of political engagement, there are certainly opportunities. Most of our parties are now active on our campuses, and we need to look at the practice of political discourse that they introduce on our campuses, and whether it advances democracy or detracts from it. And I think you as student leaders need to be influential in that regard. Well, University of Stellenbosch. It's a tough one. I think, and these are just really my rather foolish opinions, because as my dad used to say, I'm an idealist and rather naive. But I believe that if in a higher education institution you have a senior student about to graduate, or a postgraduate student who is racist and attacks a domestic worker because of her color or her gender, your university has failed. That's my view. Now, how might the university become different? I've always felt that at the gates, the entrance to our universities post-1994, every university should post the Bill of Rights on its entrance gate and say, you enter an institution where these rights are upheld. That's how the bigots are changed. The minute you don't hold to that standard, it must be clear the university will have to deal with you. But we don't have that standard. Our young people enter the university and leave it with no knowledge of our Bill of Rights, little knowledge of our Constitution. They may have our opinions and our attitudes, usually to the current government and the poor ministers, but sadly, they walk out of our university and they attack the vulnerable public. So I think we need to ask ourselves some questions about how we make visible the ambition of South Africa, which for me is in the Constitution and particularly Chapter 2, its Bill of Rights, and how our universities become a visible symbol of respect for and upholding of that Bill of Rights. I don't want us, after 200 years, to be what is happening in Ferguson in the United States. And for us to be different, we have to have at the forefront of our thinking the idea that we want to be different. And our thought leaders are primarily our intellectuals, or should be. If they're not, they must ask why. Well, I'm sure, James, you would realize that we're grappling with the issues still. If you read our newspapers and pick them up, we've not solved it. You don't solve centuries of entrenched bigotry, which even became legal bigotry. You can't solve it in 20 years. It takes many decades. It takes active programs. So it's going to be a long process. And I think everywhere, South Africa, Rwanda, we had the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, Rwanda had the community courts and other initiatives. But those interventions, because that's what they are temporal, they don't reach everyone, they don't satisfy everybody. Not everyone feels they had a voice, for example. Some people are saying, I wanted to go to the TLC, but I didn't feel safe. I didn't get my chance. I haven't articulated what apartheid did to me. Some sectors of our community refuse to go to the TLC. So the problems remain. But what is great is you, as an educated person, you have an immense opportunity to bring this resource of intellectual worth to play in a community. And that's why I say community engagement has to go alongside values. It has to go alongside ethics and new ethos, because we have to change our mind and change the way we see each other. We've got to think about each other differently. And I think that takes a very long time, but if through higher education, and even our schooling system, and all educational establishments, if this notion of the entrenching of rights and their promotion could be promoted, and not rights as rights enjoyed by individuals, but rights for the community to be better. So our whole discourse needs to change. Because I think we still view rights as individual. We view them as rights without responsibility. It's a whole host of work we need to do. And the biggest mistake we would make is to believe that we've addressed ethnicity and tribalism successfully, as well as racism. We keep having incidents in South Africa, and I think we think they're an incident. The strange thing is, a number of them involve young people.
who were never part of apartheid, who's teaching them these attitudes? Who is saying to them the black woman is worth less than you, is worth less than you? That she's able to be hit in the street with a slap? That you can mistreat her if she works for you? Why would a 20-year-old who was born in 94 have such an attitude? It means we, the adults, we have failed in some way, and we've got to use community engagement to see how we can change that. That would be my answer. But do remember, as I've said, my father told me I'm an idealist and naive. So I might just be giving you the wrong information. But I think you're absolutely correct that we should focus on the young, because they should be the future. They shouldn't be taking us back. Thank you very much.